My guest today is my friend of great many years and fellow columnist of the National Review and elsewhere, Mark Steyn, a legendary figure with an immense following all over the English-speaking world, and indeed parts of the French-speaking world, too. Thanks for joining us, Mark.
I was sitting at the Tim Hortons on the township's auto route in Magog, Quebec, and my sole francophone fan from Sherbrooke, Quebec, came up and buttonholed me in Tim Hortons. So you were correct to say that I'm a legend in the French-speaking world.
Exactly. Too. And they know you, but they don't remember who Tim Horton was.
Right.
Even though he was a formidable performer in the old Montreal Forum. Right. Mark, you're now in the midst of some litigation. And let me see if I have this correct. You have exposed the fact that Mr. Mann, one of the great propagators of the dangers of global warming, not only was mistaken with his infamous hockey stick of how suddenly the temperature of the world had shot upwards, but also that Nobel laureate Mann did not in fact win the Nobel Prize and was a complete imposter. But can you just, because if it doesn't come from you, I'm afraid our viewers won't believe quite the absurdity of this latest manifestation of the workings of the American justice system. What's actually gone on here?
Yes, I'm being sued in the District of Columbia Superior Court. Mm. And it's, as you said, it's over the Michael Mann, who's a climatologist, who is the man behind the famous hockey stick graph that the government of Canada, I believe, distributed to every man, woman, and child in the country a few years ago, basically showing the 1,000 years before the beginning of the 20th century is the flat stick of a hockey stick, and then the 20th century is this blade of the hockey stick shooting up out of the ceiling of the graph around about 1999,
yes,
and plainly looking as if we're all going to be broiling by about 2014, which we're not. And this was used by the IPCC to gin up the whole, to change the level of debate about climate change and the environment.
Into one of outright hysteria.
Yeah, and the sky is falling stuff.
Yeah.
And he's now suing me. He claimed in the complaint to accuse me of the crime of defamation of a Nobel Prize winner, because he's not a Nobel laureate.
He no more won the Nobel Prize than we did.
No, well, he won the Nobel Prize in the same sense that I did. He has an association with an organization that won the Nobel Prize, which is the IPCC in 2007. He once wrote a report for the IPCC, and they were co-awarded. They won half a Nobel Prize with Al Gore in 2007. In the same way, I'm a Nobel laureate because my mother is Belgian, and in 2012, the European Union was awarded the Nobel Peace
Prize. Yes, and I am a UK citizen, so I feel that I'm a Nobel laureate also.
That's true. This is the first time, I think, on your show we've had a Nobel to Nobel conversation.
It's as if the inventor of insulin met with Lester Pearson or something like that. Dr. Banting.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Banting meets Pearson. That's the level at which the show is operating.
Yeah. Well, in fairness to Canada, I believe the whole hockey stick theory was really debunked by two Canadians, was it not?
Yeah,
McMaster or something?
Steve McIntyre and Ross McKittrick, who two fellows from this very province, who did an awful lot of work exposing the dodgy statistical basis of the hockey stick to the point where the president of the Royal Statistical Society said that it was exaggerated and inappropriate. And if it was like any kind of hockey stick, it was more of a field hockey stick rather than an ice hockey stick. So this is, but at any rate, he's suing me, and I'm discovering it firsthand the pleasures of being on the receiving end of the U.S. justice system that you know so well,
which you covered. We spent most evenings after the kangaroo court sessions having dinner. Indeed, we had a table dedicated to us. Do you remember in that Italian restaurant?
Yeah, Spaggia, which is actually Barack Obama's favorite restaurant. And when it's strange, when people accuse you of not having much in common with Barack Obama. In fact, you two have the same favorite restaurant in Chicago. It's remarkable.
But you, if you recall, urged me to flee the jurisdiction. So you had premonitions that American justice might not be entirely condign and equitable.
Well, I think my legal advice to you, Conrad, was that you should get in the back of my pickup. I'd throw a tarp over you, drive you across the border to Quebec and over to Newfoundland, take the ferry to Saint-Pierre and Miquelon, and then charter a jet to spirit you away somewhere. And I offered you that legal advice, I think, for about $17.37. And I think it was much better legal advice than whatever you paid the $30 gazillion to those white shoe guys in Washington and elsewhere.
Well, we won at the Supreme Court finally, but those were not lawyers, unfortunately, that were acting for us in Chicago. Mark, the civil tort of defamation scarcely exists in the United States. As you know, to be successful, you have to prove intent to defame, which is very difficult to do. So do I understand that Mr. Mann is setting out to prove that you intended to defame him?
Yes, and what he is trying to do, I think, is this will be an interesting case for the First Amendment. In that,
which Canadians might not know, it's really the right to freedom of expression.
Yes, yeah. and it's supposedly broader and more absolute than in Canada or Australia or other countries within the common law tradition, and that's right to a degree, but the First Amendment really isn't worth that much if it takes you 5 years and a seven-figure sum to establish your right to say something, which is what it looks like it's going to take. In my case, I mean, I said exactly the same thing about Michael Mann in an Australian newspaper in 2006 in The Australian, which is a national newspaper down under, and he didn't sue me down there. The case everybody quotes, and which, believe me, you get sick of if you're hearing your lawyers make it all the time, is Hustler versus Falwell, which is when Larry Flint sued. Jerry Falwell had complained about, I think it was something that Larry Flint had published.
They ran
Hustler
a cartoon
magazine
of Jerry Falwell allegedly making love to his mother in an outhouse.
Right.
And the Supreme Court of the United States ultimately determined that that was not defamatory.
Right, right. And so the argument is always that as loathsome and repellent as my client is, he falls he falls just the right side of Larry Flint. Yeah. And, you know, believe me, for whatever it was, $720 an hour, you get pretty sick of that legal argument pretty quickly. And mine is actually a more absolute defense, that I believe the hockey stick graph is false, and that what it purports to show is not so, and that Dr. Mann is a ridiculous figure who has misrepresented the fact that he's a Nobel laureate, which he's not, and misrepresented the fact that he's been exonerated by multiple bodies, including the British House of Commons, which he has not, and that I am well within my rights to say this about. Once one learns about US justice, which is very procedural, I find myself sort of...
And uneven procedural.
And whimsically procedural. And I find myself sort of floating further and further away from it and saying, I don't really care anymore. I have the right to say this in Washington. I have the right to say this in Toronto. I have the right to say this in the jungles of Papua New Guinea. And that is my inalienable right. And
And you hold this truth to be self-evident.
Absolutely.
Said Mr. Jefferson, the slaveholder. If I understand this, the judge that you initially had in the District of Columbia confused the defendant's names,
right?
And and came up with a ruling that was demonstrably false in a number of key factual areas.
Well, she...
And was finally just expunged from the case.
Yes, the fact that we're in the District of Columbia, when you were tried in Chicago, which was at least, whatever one may feel about that, that was the city in which your most prominent U.S. newspaper holding was located.
Yes.
I'm being tried in the District of Columbia. Michael Mann doesn't live or work in the District of Columbia. I don't live or work in the District of Columbia. For the purposes of this lawsuit, they have deemed me to be transacting business in the District of Columbia because my columns are read in the District of Columbia. So that's in the...
But they're read in every community in the United States.
Exactly. Yeah. So it's the equivalent of, say, deeming Celine Dion to be doing business in the District of Columbia because some radio station in Washington plays one of her records. Mm. And so even that is just part of the procedural, the tedious sophistry of U.S. justice that the lawyers all seem to think is brilliant, but actually is an affront to any sane, sentient being more advanced than a cockroach.
Yeah, but the lawyers think it's brilliant because it's just one of the countless wheezes they have for running up their bills and confounding the public they're supposedly serving.
Yeah, absolutely. And so I said, well, look, I'm a Canadian who lives in New Hampshire, so I don't regard myself as being bound by this jurisdiction, but I'll voluntarily submit to the court in order to expedite this stuff. And I thought, having agreed to do that, the judge could at least do me the honor of figuring out which one of the guys in the courtroom I was. She issued this ridiculous ruling in which she confused me with my co-defendant, Rand Simberg, attributed to me all the way through her ruling, his words and his positions. And, anyone in our line of work, in the newspaper business, has found themselves in legal proceedings around the world at one time or another. I've never been in a situation where the judge can't even tell one defendant from another. That's
now, did your opponent go jurisdiction shopping? Did he choose the District of Columbia?
Yep, absolutely, absolutely.
Well, presumably because it is a notoriously leftish jurisdiction and the jury pool are all... practically all Democrats, left-wing Democrats.
Yeah,
not to get into ethnic questions.
No, I think that's probably true. I mean, I'm fancy by chances before a jury rather than the judges, to be honest. I find, and people say, I'm astonished that the Americans, who I think are an admirable people,
yes,
but they seem to have, to me, at the risk of overgeneralizing, have an excessively deferential attitude toward judges. And I floated the theory a few weeks ago that I think if you abolish a monarchy, the natural monarchical sentiment in any society has to find something else to transfer itself to.
And for a time in the U.S. it was the president, but you think it is now the bench.
Well, I think politicians are the beneficiaries of that. I mean, one of the things I like about politics in Canada is that if you run into somebody who was, Fred Smith, who was the deputy minister for multiculturalism between May 1972 and March 1974, you just say, "Hello, Mr. Smith, nice to see you. I haven't seen you in a while." In America, titles are for life. You can,
yes,
you find yourself hosting a panel on Fox News, say, with Newt Gingrich, Rick Santorum, and Mitt Romney, and it's all Mr. Speaker, Senator Santorum, Governor Romney, even though it's 20 years since Newt was a speaker. And
it goes back to your highest previous elected office. I once referred to Lloyd Benson as Mr. Secretary, because his last position was Secretary of the Treasury, official position. And eventually he said to me, "You have to call me senator because that's my last elected position."
My assistant in New Hampshire, who was excessively deferential,
I thought, on those grounds. And I'd like wander into the office and find her saying, oh, yes, Senator, no, Senator. And I'd be all excited. I'd say, who was that? Which Senator was that? And it would be like, Bud Jones, who was a state senator in New Hampshire from 1954 to 1956, but was still entitled to this. And I think that is faintly ridiculous. Yeah. I like, you know, Gladstone, Mr. Gladstone. I like that. That's fine. He stopped being prime minister and he's like Mr. Gladstone. That's fine. And I think I think the deference towards the judiciary is actually deeply damaging. And people say I shouldn't attack judges. You got into trouble with this when you were slightly too relaxed emerging from the courtroom and someone would ask you an opinion about this or that. And people would say in Chicago, oh, Judge Amy won't like it if you say that. Judge Amy won't like it if you... Well, tough, you're a judge. You're supposed to administer impartial justice. The idea that you're some great mouldering heap of neuroses who some little item on page 17 of the newspaper or a 100-word blog post will send you into some, emotional spasm that will result you in throwing the book. I mean, this is ridiculous.
Except, unfortunately, that sometimes happens. I adopted the technique in Chicago, of just replying to questions in French. I didn't reply to any of the ones in English.
No, there's a case in Boston at the moment where basically a family from Connecticut took their daughter to Boston Children's Hospital.
This is this Justina Pelletier case.
Pelletier, yeah. And they basically, the Department of DCF, Department of Child and Family Services in Massachusetts, basically kidnapped the kid.
Seized the child.
Yeah, and the judge, whose name deserves to be known, one Joseph Johnson, imposed a gag order on the father, preventing him even from talking about the fact that the Commonwealth of Massachusetts had kidnapped his daughter.
Yeah, and gave, as I understand, the parents rights to visit for only 1 hour a week.
1 hour a week with five people, including basically someone from the state police or some other agency in the room. And it was only when Mr. Pelletier actually said to hell with the gag order and started going on TV and radio and talking about the case, that this furtive little squish of a judge called Joseph Johnson actually then they've determined that the child is not going to be, they were going to foster out the child.
Yes.
That now the child will be returned, at least returned to the custody of Connecticut, which is the state she lives in. And he was going to bring the father into court for contempt of court, and he's now been forced to drop the gag order. And I think a third-rate judge should command no more respect than a third-rate plumber, and it is unbecoming to a free people, especially a supposed republic of self-governing citizens, to have this sort of prostration before their robed rulers. That
I agree, and furthermore, I think these judges are largely underworked. I mean, the Supreme Court of the United States, it's of course a life appointment. And there's intense press speculation about the subtleties and fineries of the different legal views that they might have. All of this conducted by people who haven't the remotest idea what they're writing about most of the time. And these judges take 4 months, the justices of the U.S. Supreme Court, 4 months paid vacation. They have huge staffs. Mm. They only take 70 cases a year. Mm. As the highest court of a nation of over 300 million people, which is terribly litigious, unprecedentedly litigious. And I think they're chronically underworked. And as a matter of fact, as you know, I'm a biographer of Roosevelt's, and for many years I thought it was a mistake for him to wish to expand the Supreme Court. But he was right. Mm. They should be expanded and they should work harder.
Well, I don't know whether you expand it, but I'm not in favor of a Supreme Court of this scale of supremacy. Mm-hmm. Because what it boils down to, as you say, for a start, America has a very politicized judiciary to a degree that isn't quite the same elsewhere. But so you wind up inevitably with a a divide on the Supreme Court in which, you know, the Supreme Intergalactic Emperor, Anthony Kennedy, is in fact the man who decides, he's the one who...
He's the swing judge.
Yeah, he decides same-sex marriage, you know, he's... What Anthony Kennedy thinks outpunches more than the other 320 million Americans. And that doesn't seem to me...
And he's a man whose true love is wine. As soon as the balloon goes up and his four-month vacation starts, he goes to France and goes on a test of entry for 4 months, which is, to his credit, I guess, as a man of taste. But it's easy for foreigners to criticize, and the U.S. is a successful country, but uniquely so. But legal costs are 10% of GDP, $1.8 trillion a year. Yeah. There are 4,000 statutes and regulations added each year with serious sanctions to them. Right. And it's a monster and a cartel, both.
No.
And set at the head of it, I agree with you, are these judges who are rather idolatrously over-worshipped.
Right. And I think if you look at it, I mean, to me...
Well, I speak as someone who won a unanimous victory in the Supreme Court.
Right, but it took, you know, it took you the best part of a decade of your life. And that's...
And cost $30 million.
Right. And that's a very high price to pay. And what is... What I find repugnant is, you know all this back to front because your case was a highly evolved example of that. But what's fascinating me is about all the worst features of American justice. For example, the settlement, the assumption that you won't exercise your right to be tried by a jury of your peers, but that simply initiating the legal process will force you to so-called settle, as they say. Yeah. I got a supposed stoplight violation in a little town in upstate New York, and I thought it the trooper who pulled me over, I thought it was unjust, and I thought the ticket was unjust. So it was, I forget what it was. It was a $200 ticket maybe, and so I contested it. So I went to this little town courthouse, a town court. In what looked like a kind of abandoned candy store. I mean, it had a candy store window, so you could see me and all the other town deadbeats sitting there waiting to be called up before the judge. And I said, not guilty. I turned up to make my case. I said, not guilty. And the town prosecutor, who I think in a just system would at that point have had to put on his case, then asked to adjourn so he could have time to prepare his case, which would mean to call the deadbeat cop and get him to show up for the hearing, which he had failed to do. So I said, fine, I'll come back. You give me another date and I'll come back from New Hampshire and do the thing. The town prosecutor from this nothing little town of, 400 people hands me his card and says, give me a call and maybe we can talk about a deal, which means I'm innocent. You know, I like guilty. I was innocent of that stop sign violation. But he thought, hey, look, we can plead it down to a misdemeanor. It'll be, and we'll drop the whole thing in return for you making a $100 donation to Mothers Against Stop Sign Running or something like that. And that's the way. And so I couldn't get over this, for a nothing little stop sign violation. Oh, give me a tour, give me a call. We can talk. We can settle it. The judge then writes back to me a couple of weeks later, saying he wants me to come back to this town to meet with the town prosecutor so we can have a scheduling conference. Right, a scheduling conference for a stop sign violation. And I write back and I say, I'm in a bad mood. My assistant reads this to me as I'm just on my way out the door. So I say, take a letter, write this. Dear Judge so-and-so, no, I don't want to come to your court for a scheduling conference. Over my stop sign violation, I said, I stand on the assize of Clarendon in the year 1166, 50 years before Magna Carta, guaranteeing the right to a speedy trial. If I had that right as a 12th century peasant, I think I should enjoy
which
that
is in
right
the Sixth Amendment of the Constitution. Yeah. Everyone's entitled to prompt justice. Right, no one gets it.
No one gets it. Yeah. No one gets it. It doesn't mean anything. Yeah. Prompt justice means if you're lucky,
within 5, 6, 7 years. And it's ridiculous.
And in your current proceeding with Mr. Mann, it's one of these, you moved for an expedited hearing to dismiss his case.
Yeah, we filed under the anti-SLAPP statute, which, and I love this. This is, again, characteristic of the system. SLAPP is the stands for Strategic Lawsuit Against Public Prosecution.
Participation,
which is when people file lawsuits in effect to take you out of the game.
Right.
So in other words, while you're fighting off the lawsuit, you're not actually engaging in public policy discussions. And so it was the anti-SLAPP statute, which I think started in California, came up as a way to sort of say, no, we'll get this thing tossed out quickly and life will continue. And instead, in the District of Columbia, the anti-SLAPP phase of the case went on for a year and a half. So it's just become something that is designed to expedite a swift revolution.
Just front ends it for longer.
Yeah, just in effect becomes another way of adding another 18 months of lawyer bills to the whole process. Yeah,
no, it's appalling. Now, let us, just, I want to make one comment. The criminal justice system is even more odious, as you know. 99.5% of prosecutions are successful to some degree. They may not win, but, you know, they throw 180 counts at somebody, so maybe they only win 10 of them, but every one carries a huge penalty. And
by the way, that, I believe, I said at the time of your trial, and I believe that this multi-count thing is one of the most disgusting features of the system.
As it is.
Because it means that it plays to a jury's sense of its own judiciousness.
Yeah.
Because it invites a jury to say, well, there's 20 counts, and yeah, the prosecution didn't make a very good case, so we'll acquit on 18, but we'll convict on 2. And those 2 will be enough to destroy a man's life.
Sure.
And it's the same thing. You know, I wrote a 200-word blog post, and there are, I think, at the moment, 7 separate counts, 7 separate complaints that Michael Mann has filed against me. And it's easy to foresee a jury, again, a wise, judicious, Solomonic jury, saying we'll quit on 6 of them, but we'll find him guilty on the 7th, and that in itself will be enough for a damages in the high 7 figures. I mean, it's very corrupt. That
it is, but the 99.5% success rate for prosecutions. It's about 61% in Ontario.
Right.
It's a little over 50% in the United Kingdom.
Right.
And that's not because our prosecutors are incompetent.
No.
It's because the defense has some rights. And of that, the shocking thing to me is, of that 99.5%, 97% are without a trial.
Right, right.
Because the plea bargain system is so abused. If they target you, they go after the 8 people closest to you in the activity objected to, and they say, I'm sure you remember some incriminating evidence about Mr. Steyn, and your friends will say, no, I certainly do not. He's an honest man. I don't believe he did anything criminal. They said, well, you better jog your memory, because if you don't, it's a conspiracy of silence. You're part of it, and we'll indict you.
Right, right.
Whereupon, you saw what happened with the prosecution witnesses who came into our case. They all lied. We tore them to pieces. Even the jurors, who were not Solomonic.
Right.
They can be accused of a lot of things, and you, in your descriptions of them and what you wrote, highlighted some of those things, but they're not Solomonic. But they said, unanimously, we did not believe one word those witnesses said.
No,
not a word.
And it was kind of pathetic, because you had former governor of Illinois.
Four-term governor.
And distinguished ambassadors and other. And
head of the Museum of Modern Art.
And they'd all been threatened with these things called Wells letters, which makes it, in other words, you don't, they're the kind of people, the governor in particular, is the kind of person who makes his living from serving on the boards of companies. A very agreeable lifestyle. You go and sit in a meeting for a couple of hours every few months. And
get $100,000 a year.
Yeah, and so you sit on enough of those, you have a very nice life. And so a Wells letter, which would prevent you from doing that and would oblige you to get up in the morning and go to work, is actually a fairly concentrates the mind wonderfully.
Exactly.
And so they all, but to go back to what you were saying about the way most of these cases never come to trial. When I was watching your case in Chicago in the federal courthouse, which was packed because you had all these reporters from Canada and Britain following the trial, I had to come out in the breaks and make phone call in to dictate my blog updates for McLean's on the trial and thing. And so I was always looking for a quiet place in that building where I could make a phone call in private. And I figured out, I think in about the second week of the trial, that the quietest place in the building where you could be undisturbed was all the other courthouses, because there were no trials going on in any of them.
All the other courtrooms.
Yeah.
Yes.
Every courtroom on your floor, all the courtrooms on the floor below, all the courtrooms on the floor below, floor above, all completely empty. No trials going
on. And the courthouse, as you know, is a colossal building of about 40 stories. Right, and it's a monument to the influence of the Daley family.
Right.
Whenever, you know, anything we needed, a jury selection, I mean, the judge would say, well, just take one of the courtrooms down the hall. They're not occupied.
Yeah, nobody's using them. Yeah. Nobody's using them.
And the judges who are there operate a motions court for 2 hours a week, and the rest of the time they run an automobile accessory store or something.
Right, because there's no, that's all it is. They're basically signing off on procedural delays most of the rest of the time. So everyone, once every so often, you go into court for 10 minutes and the judge rules on a motion that in effect delays the whole thing for another 6 or 8 months.
And did you notice the pathetic spectacle of these legal aid cases, the public defenders, who were stooges of the prosecutors in the United States? And these poor people who would be, if they weren't poor to begin with, they're quickly run out of money because you've got to be extremely wealthy and have your assets outside the U.S. to be able to fight a trial in that country. And, I mean, against the government. They were frog marched in, treated very evidently contemptuously by their counsel, the public defenders, and they were just in a sausage factory on their way to the prison system.
No, and that's true all the way down. I mean, I find at the time of your case, a neighbor of mine in New Hampshire was attracted the attention of the United States Department of Justice, which is a corrupt institution.
The greatest racketeering organization in the world.
And this guy, he was a doctor, and for part of the week he worked at the Veterans Administration, which is run by the United States government, therefore federal jurisdiction. This friend of mine, the Department of Justice decides he's guilty of some contractual infraction. Like, it's one of those cases nobody can explain. It's like all the guys who hate you can nevertheless not explain what it is that you're actually guilty of. They can't do that. If you ever say...
Because I was in fact innocent.
But if you say, Conrad Black, he's a criminal, and you say, okay, what is it he actually did? And no, they can't explain it. It's the same in this guy's case. Nobody can explain what in anything other than a 700-page motion... what it is that this guy's guilty of. 7 years. Destroyed his marriage. Drove him to two or three suicide attempts. He eventually winds up in federal court in Brattleboro, Vermont, and a jury tosses it out of there in 45 minutes. Doesn't matter. By then, he's broke. Marriage is over. And
he's a mental case.
Yeah. And it doesn't matter. So it doesn't matter. They don't care whether they lost in 45 minutes because they destroyed the guy's life.
No, of course they don't care. That's all part of the deal. Look, we're not here to talk about me, but given the correlation of forces between the United States of America and its local Canadian Quisling acolytes on the one side and myself on the other, I count it as something of a success that, as you can see, I'm still married, I'm not broke, and my mental health is quite good.
No, you're still standing. But I mean, a lot of the whole point of the system is to say it's not worth you
exercising your claim to innocence. It's not worth you claiming the right to a trial. It's not, it's the whole system is geared to people saying, okay, maybe I'm not as guilty as you say I am, but I concede I'm 67% guilty. And Dinesh D'Souza down in New York, he made the mistake of making a film about Obama that was slightly too big a hit. I'm not a friend of Dinesh D'Souza. I don't particularly like him. I don't particularly like his books. I've got no brief for him.
You're a pretty good writer sometimes.
Well, you know, up to a point. We'll politely agree to disagree on that. But he is now being accused of a $15,000 campaign finance infraction that they have supposedly identified by very spurious means. He has basically had to he has had to give a six-figure sum in bail. He was handcuffed.
Everyone's handcuffed
for $15,000. He has had to surrender his passport, so he's in New York, but he can't give a speech in Toronto, and he cannot travel internally within the United States. In other words, he can't give a speech in Boston without getting the permission of the judge. I'm sorry, this stuff just doesn't pass the smell test. And Americans should be ashamed of themselves at letting their federal justice system particularly degenerate in this way.
You know, Dinesh D'Souza went to university with my dear friend Laura Ingram, who, Dartmouth. And who is a wonderful person. And I had, and you know, she is just a very fine person in every respect, but I had a rather fierce exchange on the telephone with her the other day when she used that abominable cliche that it's sort of like one of Dr. Skinner's experiments or Pavlov on reflexes, when she said, well, it's a menace to our exceptionalism. Whereupon I thought I was going into orbit, you see, and I said, exceptionalism. You speak of American exceptionalism. And I mean, it is a great country. And in my way, I'm still pro-American, despite what they did to me. It's a wonderful country, and they're right to be proud of it. But it isn't exceptional other than its scale. In all other respects, it is the supreme irony that we owe it the triumph of democracy in the world, but it isn't a very well-functioning democracy. And Americans still, even a perceptive, fine person like that who knows everything about U.S. public policy doesn't realize it.
Well, I think that, I mean, that's one of, I think that is one of the problems I have with the U.S. right now. I mean, I have a lot of friends who are members of the Republican Party and supporters of the Republican Party and are candidates for the Republican Party and all the rest of it. But the fact is, the Republican Party has been absolutely grotesquely fiscally irresponsible, not just by comparison with conservative ministries in Canada or Australia or New Zealand, but actually with by comparison with left of center parties in those countries. I mean, the Republican Party is more fiscally irresponsible than the Canadian Liberal Party or the Australian Labour Party.
Yes. Australian Labour Party is not a party of the left.
No, it always says it's Kevin Rudd, briefly the Australian Prime Minister, a man of relatively disgusting man in many respects.
He politically disgusting.
He ate his own earwax live on TV, apparently. But he
which
was,
has something to do with why he's an ex prime minister.
But he when we met and I shook his hands, not then knowing of his earwax habit. He said, "Great to meet you, Mark. I'm a member of the. I regard myself as a member of the pro-American left." Mm-hmm. And I said, "Crikey," as one does in Australia.
Yes.
I don't think there's a pro-American left in America, and I think you're right that the Australian Labor Party. I think that's actually a serious. You know, when the best. If you look at the proposals coming out from, you know, Paul Ryan, say, who is supposedly the man who wants to shove your granny off the cliff, according to the attack ads against him, he's got plans to, like, balance the budget by
in eight years or something.
Well, no, not in 8 years. Like in, it's like mid-century. I mean, these are not the getting American spending on. Or if you look at the Bipartisan Debt Commission, the Blue Ribbon Commission,
Alan Simpson and Bowles was it?
Yeah, Simpson Bowles. Yeah. Their big thing was to raise the age of Social Security eligibility to 69. By the year 2075.
Yes.
That, like, in other words, a serious commission in a supposedly democratic society can do no better than say, we're going to, that's broke, can say we're going to raise the age of Social Security eligibility to 69 by 2075. That's not good enough.
And the average age expectancy in the United States has risen by 17 years since President Roosevelt passed Social Security in 1935.
No, I
so
mean,
we, I mean, what are they talking about?
Yeah, and basically, so I mean, in terms of the overall liabilities of what they call entitlements in the U.S., Americans are basically the debt total debt level per family is about $750,000. So you're looking at a country that is on course to become the first nation of negative millionaires. I mean, it is. It is
by which you mean every man, woman, and child is a negative.
Right. And if you just run those numbers, total, just take the federal debt. Mm. Total federal debt per person in Canada, $12,000. Mm. Total federal debt in New Zealand, $15,000. In Australia, $12,000. In New Zealand, $15,000. In Canada, 18,000. Yeah. In America, 54,000.
But in Germany, it's only about 7,000.
Right. So this is, you know, Laura Ingraham is very smart, and a lot of commentators are very smart. But at some point, people have to grapple with the fact that these numbers outpunch all your mythology.
Yeah.
I live in a state whose license plate slogan is live free or die. And I believe in that.
That's from Mr. Stark.
Yeah, that's General Stark's words 200 years ago, declining a dinner invitation. I always thought it was a blood-curdling battle cry.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
But he was in fact just declining a dinner invitation. Yeah. And he puts... Which reminds us that it's not just a battle cry, it's actually about how you live your life every day.
Yeah.
And the fact is, you know, it's fine to have live free or die on the license plate. It's fine to have don't tread on me on your T-shirt. So I saw a guy at LaGuardia who had a don't tread on me T-shirt, and he was being taken off for secondary screening by the TSA, who were treading all over him.
Yeah.
At some point... You've got to take this these slogans seriously.
Yeah.
And if they're just T-shirt slogans, then they're useless. There's no point to it. There's no point to stick it in on the license plate. There's no point to having it on your T-shirt unless it means something more than raising the age of Social Security eligibility to 69 by the age of 2075. In that case, you're treading on everybody.
One of the reasons that General George Washington called for an indissoluble union at the Constitutional Convention that he and Benjamin Franklin convened that produced the Constitution, was to endow the country with a strong and reliable currency. It was an indissoluble union with a strong and reliable currency that would provide for its own defense. Mm. And they settled the indissolubility of the union in the Civil War. 750,000 Americans died. It was a terrible war, but they resolved it. And they had a responsible, reliable currency up into our lifetimes,
right.
But they don't now. And but you know, they took care of indissolubility. They certainly have defended themselves from outsiders, but it is rotting within. The U.S. isn't threatened from the outside, but the country is falling apart. It's a shambles.
No, and I think that's the sad thing about it is that it saw off. The great mortal threats of the 20th century,
yes.
including finally communism, the great ideological threat to the planet, of the late 20th century.
It led us to the victory over the Nazis also.
Right, right. In essence, it's in this unipolar world the scale of things, I think, I picked up the National Post the other day, and they had Alison Redford from Alberta in there. People were complaining that she'd spent $9,200 to fly herself, her daughter, and two staffers back from Palm Springs for Ralph Klein's funeral. And the reality, and I thought...
Well, what's wrong with that?
Well, I thought that works out, what is that, 9,200 or 4,000, so that's $2,300 per person. Mm-hmm. And I thought there was something actually incredibly refreshing to be in a country where a premier can be attacked for spending $9,200. Because if you look at the imperial bloat, you know, where Obama has to take a 47-car motorcade to pretend to visit an ice cream parlor in Martha's Vineyard.
Or Bill Clinton stops Air Force One on the main runway at Los Angeles Airport to have his haircut and delays 200 airliners.
I know. I find once you start noticing that it bothers me. It ought to bother everybody. I would love a guy who actually had the difference between the two parties at the moment is not wide enough to make a difference, because basically
two American parties?
Yes,
they're both awful.
It's a bipartisan,
and their leaders are awful.
Well, and it's a bipartisan. It's basically a bipartisan guarantee of decline, and I believe it's a bipartisan exit from the first world, because I don't believe this idea that somehow America can be a large Sweden. I don't think that's an option. I think
But Mark, let me here come to the rescue of the United States. Conversationally, obviously, it is, in fact, fundamentally a very strong country. It's rich in natural resources. Mm. It has by far the most productive workforce in the history of the world. It is astounding what it can do when it gets some leadership. It is a reasonably homogeneous society, a tolerably law-abiding society, and it has had a system of government that, while it's dysfunctional now, has served it quite well for most of its history. And I put it to you that when it has needed leadership, and it has. It has been critically in need of great leadership at certain times to keep moving up in its position in the world and the fulfillment of the potential that the creators of the mythos of America foresaw. When it has needed that leadership, it has got it. Now, it could happen again, in which case most of these problems would be set on the road to resolution quite quickly, because the American public are patriotic. They're not like the French or the Italians, who are complete cynics. They love their country. They stand their hand over heart saying all this rubbish about the land of the free and so on. They actually believe this bunk, and they want a president who will lead them.
Well,
I don't mean in a fascistic way. I mean just to do the job the president's paid to do.
Well, I love that side of America. I think if you live in small town New Hampshire as I do, it's very hard not to be moved by the authentic, genuine, simple, plain-spoken patriotism of a small town 4th of July parade that has been essentially, the rituals of my town have been essentially unchanged since the 19th century. But if you go back to...
Or even the 18th.
Well, if you go back to, say... Rutherford B. Hayes, who was mocked by Obama for, he peddled, Obama, with his usual carelessness, said that Hayes had been shown the telephone and said, well, it's very nice, but I can't see what the use of it would be.
That's rubbish.
In fact, that's not true. Mm. And Hayes was an advanced man, and he had the first typewriter in the White House and all the rest of it.
And furthermore, he was a general of volunteers. He was a successful governor of Ohio, and he was a much better president than Obama, and he was a man of honor. He said he wouldn't seek a second term, and he didn't.
Right. And
when Obama was doing his cheap sneers about, hey, oh, that's why he's not on Mount Rushmore and everything, Rutherford Hayes came back today, he would not be impressed by the fact that, you know, Obama has this little device from Apple that fits in his pocket that he can listen to Justin Bieber on. That would not attract
Canada's very own
Canada's very own Justin Bieber. That would not attract his attention at all. What would attract his attention, in fact, is that the entire population of the United States in President Hayes's day, 50 million people, is now on food stamps. That's staggering to me. That's the population. That's basically the population of Canada and the population of Australia, less a couple of million, on food stamps. Yeah. That's extraordinary. Absolutely extraordinary.
There are 48 million convicted felons in the U.S. Even if you take out the unstigmatizing issues, you know, plowed a breathalyzer 20 years ago, or were disorderly at a fraternity party 25 years ago or something, which wouldn't affect a person's ability to get a job. If you take it all out, it still means that 15% of the adult male population are felons. Well, this is nonsense. Yeah. We're talking about the land of the free here.
People put up with it.
There's something about the American character, and I suppose it has to do with the tremendous genius of the spectacle they have and their ability to sell themselves on the manifest destiny and predestined mission of America. Starting with taking what was really a grubby little dispute about taxes and claiming it was the dawn of human liberty and so on, which was essentially a lot of bilges, you know. And they had no more liberty at the end of the revolution than they had at the beginning, and no more than a citizen of Britain or even Canada had. But that's not the issue. Something about their ability at promotion and the scale of the country leads not only to this great ambition and work ethic and profit motive, but also to sort of awful complacency. You just can't reason with Americans at times. I mean, Roosevelt sent out 50 warnings about a possible Japanese attack, and on the day that Pearl Harbor was attacked, everybody was asleep. There were no torpedo nets around the battleship. Hundreds of aircraft were sitting out in the middle of the runway. No one was flying a patrol out anywhere to see if anyone was approaching. I mean, the Americans are they are complacent until they you get their attention, then they're very formidable.
Well, I think they tend to approach threats the way they do hurricanes. Like if you see the thing about on television, you know, the network correspondents are there, you know, in the wind cheaters wrapped around a lamppost saying the governor has ordered an evacuation of all coastal areas. There's like still street signs are flying down the street, taking out car windows. People are still strolling around, coming out of Price Chopper with a six pack and refusing to get out. And then when the hurricane hits, and the entire town is flooded, then they all do something. It's not an... And I think, you know, realistically, that's the same way it's going to go with the Iranian nuclear program, that it's not an anticipatory culture like that. And in some ways, that's admirable. And in some ways, it's, you know, you're obviously dicing with fairly disastrous outcomes.
But when the debt bomb blows up, and whoever the president is, and let us, for the sake of the whole planet, hope it's someone with a greater grasp of these issues than the incumbent, but says, this is the problem, these are the proportions of the problem, this is what's going to happen if we don't deal with it, and here is my plan of action to deal with it, they will support him, or her.
I would hope so. You know, you reach, and this is, I think, the danger in Washington at the moment. That when you talk about that, even just to keep it on the official figures, the $17 trillion and everything, and you talk with anyone in Washington, you can see in their eyes that there's no serious intention, actually, to do anything to pay it back, to start paying it down or paying it back, And at the same time, when you talk to them about political solutions like reforming Medicare or Social Security or whatever, there's no political will to reform those programs. And if that's not possible, then what's the point of, you know, shaving off $4 million from some little nickel and dime program in the Department of Whatever's Bureau of Complacency? There's no need. There's no need. What's the point?
The Ministry of Silly Walks.
Yeah. If there's an assumption, I think, in Washington among the political class that nothing can be done, and that the institutions of Washington don't allow for meaningful course correction. And that's actually quite extraordinary, I would say.
I mean, when you consider that in this country, and I'm not a habitual waver of the maple leaf flag in an unreasonable way, but we ran some moderately large deficits, we as a country thought at the time.
Right.
Then all of a sudden this consensus developed of both parties, and we ran 15 consecutive balanced budgets.
Right.
And there was no difficulty selling the bonds of the country. We didn't have to have recourse to this shell game the Americans have, where they're unsold half of them, so they sell them to a 100% subsidiary of the Treasury, which pays for them by issuing notes. I mean, it's just a scam.
Well, no, this
Canada
is,
never got to that kind of thing.
No, I mean, the if you, as I understand, the federal budget introduced in Ottawa a couple of weeks ago, there was a $6 billion deficit last year, and there's projected to be an $18 billion surplus this year. Now, those are like rounding errors in not just in the Obama budget, but in the management of any Obama cabinet department. Mm-hmm. Nobody cares about $6 billion sums. Nobody cares about the United States government spends something like $185 million an hour that it doesn't have. And as you say, it's basically its left hand is issuing the debt to its right hand. The Federal Reserve is buying debt from the U.S. Treasury, which is basically like paying off your MasterCard with your Visa card at the end of the month. I mean, they're both the same. They're both the same thing.
Yeah.
And if they weren't doing that, then the United States government is basically asking the rest of the planet to sink a fifth of its GDP into U.S. U.S. government debt in perpetuity. I mean, that's like that's astonishing. That cannot go on, and that will not go on. And if we were all sitting around in my state, in New Hampshire, at the Mount Washington Hotel, having the Bretton Woods Conference, nobody in the present circumstances would say, well, we're going to make the global currency the currency of a country that's running trillion-dollar deficits, that's basically spending $185 million an hour that it doesn't have, and that's issuing its right hand is issuing its debt to its left hand. Nobody, if we were sitting around in the Mount Washington Hotel, which is almost as comfortable as this fine studio, Conrad, nobody would be planning on making the dollar the global currency today.
No, and look, in 233 years of American independence, they built up a deficit of $10 trillion in 2009, and now it's almost $18
trillion. Right.
It's just unbelievable. Right. Well, Mark, do we or do we not agree that the United States will, in fact, pull itself together at some point?
I think there's tremendous strength and unique talents and energy there in the United. I mean, I'm torn. I fell in love with New Hampshire, and I fell in love with the New England town meeting system of government that Tocqueville admired, I think Woody Allen like to say that he spent his whole time wandering around Manhattan looking for Cole Porter's New York. And I tend to wander around New Hampshire looking for Jacksonian America, the America that Tocqueville traveled around. And I believe in that system of a decentralized republic of self-governing citizens. You cannot, amass power at the center the way Obama and others have done in a nation of 300 million and not expect it to transform itself into something utterly unrecognizable from the United States as it has been throughout its history. It has to be, I think, a decentralized republic or nothing. And I do hope they recover that. I have tremendous faith in the American people. But when I see the food stamps thing is not small. It distorts everything. It means you go to a town that once used to have a normal economic profile, and instead the supermarket sells everything on the first, second, and third days of the month when the new food stamp money is put on the debit card, and the shelves are empty for the rest of the month because no one's got any money, so it's not worth restocking them. It distorts, and that's the same thing that has cursed and blighted Britain, for example, where you have this like multi-generational welfare families. Mm. Where a kid has no idea, because the kid's parents don't work, the grandparents don't work, nobody in the family works. And the idea that you get up in the morning, you put your hat and coat on and walk out at the front door and you don't come back until you've finished at 5:30 or 6 o'clock is entirely alien to them. And once that's the great evil of welfare is that it is not principally the waste of money, but the waste of people. And you're deforming your human capital when you do that. And I worry when there's 50 million people on food stamps, I don't think that's a small thing.
It isn't, of course it isn't. We should just touch for a minute before we conclude on your well-known views about the Islamic menace. I don't want to sort of shape it for you, and we all know that Islamic extremists are a terrible nuisance, but are you one of those who believe that they're going demographically to undermine the West, especially in Europe?
Well, I think there's people have these arguments and think it matters that the issue is whether Muslims eventually form 51% of the population of, say, Belgium or France. And that's not really the issue. And people who think about demographics should know better than to put it in those terms. I think the issue is that once you get up to 20%, then the accommodation of Islam becomes a central fact in your political life. So in other words, if you think Israel is unpopular in continental Europe now, wait until the Muslim population is over 20% and then see how much support Israel gets for its next incursion into Lebanon or wherever. So it impacts your foreign policy. It impacts your domestic policy in all kinds of ways, things like sex-segregated sessions at municipal swimming pools will become the norm. A blind eye will be turned to female genital mutilation and all the rest of it. And at some point, the whole assumption, I mean, in Canada, for example, or in most Western countries, when identity groups butt up against each other, it's very clear. If a gay couple sues a Christian bed and breakfast because they won't give them the luxury suite, everyone knows that you're meant to be on the side of the gay couple, and the uptight Christian homophobes have to get with the beat, get with the program. At some point, we'll get a situation. I remember walking down the Boulevard de Maisonneuve in Montreal, and shortly after 9/11, and seeing a covered Muslim woman in the hijab, struggling with shopping bags, walking, as they often do, a few feet behind her big-bearded husband who was sauntering along, unburdened. Mm-hmm. And they were walking past a gay sex boutique. And I wish I'd had, I'm not sure, I can't remember whether they had phone cameras back then, but I wish I'd had one just to take a little snap of the internal contradictions of the multicultural society. But I remember thinking even then, the woman in the hijab is here to stay, the gay sex boutique full of paraphernalia
for acts I could not reliably perform, I don't think. But the
or even guess at them.
But I strolled out a few years later. I strolled out of that same stretch of the Boulevard de Maisonneuve, and what do you know? The gay sex boutique had gone. You know, and that's the point.
But were there still covered women waddling about the shopping bins?
That's right, and I think they feel that they take the long view, and I think they're not necessarily wrong about that.
Well, they take whatever view they think they can adopt that would plausibly get them where they want to go. I mean, they're not a very successful element of the world's population, but they think if they just breed fervently enough, they will outnumber us all.
Well, I think
you see, I put my faith in the French because, despite all their pious bunk about liberty, equality, and fraternity, when they feel truly threatened in their ability to enjoy that magnificently rich country, its wine and its cheese and its language and everything, they'll just matraque all the covered heads. They won't stand for it. Now, I don't approve of that, by the way, but they are going to lead us in the counterattack on Islam just because they will not put up with being disturbed in the enjoyment of their country.
Well, that might well be so, but you have to be, I do think at a certain, I think, for example, if you take, say, Antwerp, there are more where in the grade schools, in the elementary schools, the children have to take a confessional class. And there are now more takers for the Muslim confessional class.
You mean confessional sense of a religious teaching?
Yes. And there are now more takers for the Muslim class than for the Catholic class. Now that's Antwerp, and that's elementary school, so that's children under 10, 11.
Some of that would be Belgian atheism, though, wouldn't it?
No, it's not. It's something is underfoot. I speak as a, as I said earlier, as the son of a Belgian Nobel Prize winner from the European Union's great honor, I think it's odd that, you know, my mother's Flemish, and the great division in Belgium has been between Flemish and Walloon. The idea that in a few years' time it'll be Sunni and Shia would seem utterly bewildering to Austria.
The Flemish are half Catholic and half Protestant?
They're a little more Catholic than that. If you take Austria, where it's predicted that by 2040 the majority of young Austrians will be Muslims, I mean that's an astonishing thing. If all you know about Austria is the opening titles of The Sound of Music, you think, well, how did that happen? You know,
Austria, the country of which Konrad Adenauer said it had performed the greatest public relations miracle in modern history by convincing the world that it was the country of Beethoven and that Germany was the country of Hitler.
Exactly. And in some ways as the kind of prototype multicultural society which the Habsburg Empire was, the idea of of what's left of Austria becoming a predominantly Muslim state is
since the Turks were stopped at the gates of Vienna twice.
Right.
Mark, it's always lovely to talk to you you.
Lovely to talk with you too. And by the way, I must say something because George Jonas wrote a terrific column on this. I was completely disgusted by the actions of whatever committee advised the Governor General on the matter of the Order of Canada, and I was also disgusted by the actions of the Prime Minister with respect to the Privy Council. And I think it's I agree with everything George said in that tremendous column. It was absolutely disgraceful.
Oh, thank you. Can't say I disagree with you. Very kind of you to mention it.
No, I mentioned Mr. Gladstone earlier. You know, a man is not defined by the baubles that are hung around him any more than when they're peremptorily yanked off him. So none of that matters.
Yeah. Mr. Gladstone, indeed, formed a cabinet at the age of 83.
Right. You'll do the same.
Thank you, Mark.